pin, combinatorics, finite automata. So I am glad to introduce Boris Adamczewski from CNRS in Lyon, France. And the title of his talk is about a problem about Mahler functions.
Okay, so thank you for the invitation. So in this talk, I would like to present a result I recently proved with Jason Bell from Waterloo University, and which is related to so-called Mahler functions and Mahler type equations. It is not directly related to transcendence, but it has its origin in transcendence theory. So I will start by recalling few facts about transcendence theory in order to explain the question. So the most of transcendence theory is related to the values at algebraic point of some analytic functions. So the typical situation is you have an analytic function, say f of z is a sum of an cn, say whose coefficients are algebraic numbers, so we are in q bar of z. So you have such an analytic function, and you pick an algebraic number, so let alpha be in q bar, and the question is whether f of alpha is transcendental or not. And it is well known that you cannot expect to have a good answer to this question unless the answer may be yes or no. And you really need to put some very strong restriction on your analytic function if you want to hope to have. Which word?
Just that word in
this one?
Yeah, that word. Yeah.
Transcendental. Okay. It's a very important word in this talk. So, so usually you are not able to expect a good answer, except if you put some strong restriction. And one important way was opened by Ziegel. So you need to put some restrictions on your function. So Ziegel, in a famous paper in 1929, it suggests to look at the case where your analytic function satisfies a linear differential equation. So f satisfies a linear differential equation. Which means that we are looking at something like P0 of z, f of z, plus P1 of z, f prime of z, plus something like P, say, r of z, the r's derivative of f is equal to 0, with polynomials, not all zero, polynomials pi, say with algebraic coefficient. So even if you restrict to your attention to solution of such linear differential equation, it's not still not enough, and you have to put also some restriction on say the arithmetical growth of the coefficient here of your functions. And what Ziegel suggests is to look at two big families of functions. So the first one are called the E functions. Perhaps I should write before. So plus restrictions. I don't want to give them explicitly. Restriction on the arithmetic growth of the sequence of coefficient a n. So the two families are first the E functions. Which are reminiscent to the exponential function. So in this family, so E functions are entire functions. They are analytic on the whole complex plane. And in this family, you have the exponential functions. Function like the Bessel function. Okay, and so on. And the other big family of interest is the family of G function. They are defined in a similar way, but they are no more entire functions. Okay, and they are reminiscent to the geometric series. So inside you have algebraic function. The polylogarithm function. And so in particular, if you look at the value at algebraic points, here you will have the values, say, of the exponential of an algebraic point. And here you have plenty of very interesting values, like pi, zeta values, so zeta at odd integers. And more generally, for those who knows what it is, periods, numbers, so which are integral of algebraic function over some domain defined by polynomial with rational coefficients. So the situation is like this. So, so people also, instead of looking only a single solution of a differential equation, they are also mainly interested in a system of differential equations. So you can also look, replace this by a system like with where you have several functions. Say you look at f prime 1 of z, fm prime of z, so a vector or function, which satisfy an equation like this, a of z times f1 of z, fm of z. And here, this is a matrix with rational function as coefficient. So coefficient in q bar of z. And so if you have one member of a such system, you satisfy a differential equation, and if you satisfy a differential equation, you may be a member of such a system. So when people in transcendence look at this kind of systems, the ultimate goal is to prove that if at some algebraic point there is a relation between the values of f, it comes from a relation between the function themselves. Okay? And in the case of E functions, we have a almost complete results about the relation between values and relation between functions due to result of Ziegler, Shidlovsky, Nesterenko, and more recently, André and Bakers. So really we have, for E function, for this entire function, they prove the ultimate things you may want to prove in transcendence theory. So you know that any algebraic relation between values at algebraic point comes from a relation between functions. Unfortunately, the situation is much less good for G functions. For instance, we do not know if zeta of 3 is transcendental, and there are many open questions in this area, and this is really bad because many very interesting numbers belongs to the class of values of J function. Okay? but these are the two main classes. And in this talk, we will be concerned with what I call matter function. So now I'm going to give a definition. And the idea is to look at functions that satisfy an equation like this, but in which we replace differentiation by the operator z gives zk, where k is at least 2 is an integer. Okay, so definition. So we start with a field K, and we say that a power series f of z with coefficient in K is K-Mahler, or is a K-Mahler function, or satisfy a K-Mahler equation. If one can find polynomial, not all zero, such that P0 of z f of z plus P1 of z f of z to the k plus pr of z f of z to the k to the r is equal to zero. The pi are polynomial in z. And of course not all zero. So it's really the same as those one, but where you replace differentiation by z gives zk, okay? So again, in a similar way, you can consider system of equation of Mahler type functional equation. So you can also look at something like with several functions like f of zk, a vector fm of zk is equal to a of z f1 of z, fm of z, where a of z is again a matrix with rational function as coefficient, so in a similar way as this. So in that case, there are two main goals. So the first one is to prove the transcendence of values at algebraic point of function like this, or to describe the algebraic relation between the values of members of such a system with respect to the relation between the functions. Okay? So this is very similar to the case of E or G function. And so this is called Mahler function because at the beginning, at the same time, so it's starting also, perhaps a little bit sooner, but around 1929, so Mahler first considered not exactly this kind of equation, but Mahler looked at the transcendence for function which satisfy equation like f of zk is a rational function in z and f of z. So here it's a rational bivariate function. So it's a bit different type of equation, but Mahler start by proving transcendence at algebraic point for this kind of solution of functional equation. But during the 80s, people move to this system of functional equation mainly for two reasons, because it's more closely related to what's happened with E functions, and also because it has some strong connection with automata theory. So I will discuss in a few minutes. So this is why we still call this Mahler function, because the method for proving transcendence for the values of such functions was introduced by Mahler himself. Okay, so yes, perhaps one comment. If you choose a very basic example, it's easier to deal with this kind of functional equation here and here, so it's easier to work with Mahler's methods than with Ziegler methods. Because, for instance, here you don't need Ziegler lemma. But today, the results, the situation is like this, so here we have an optimal result for E functions, while here we are still far from having an optimal result for this kind of functional equation. So now the situation is much better for the case of E functions. So with Mahler's method, you can prove transcendence results. So I give just few examples of numbers you can obtain. And so you can prove transcendence, for instance, of numbers like if you choose the Fn to be the Fibonacci sequence, so you will be able to prove the transcendence of this sum, the sum of the 1 over 2 to the k plus 1. So f of 2 to the k plus 1, where Fn is a Fibonacci sequence. So it's transcendental. It's quite amusing because if you look at the sum of 1 over f just 2 to the k is an algebraic number. It's 7 minus square root of 5 divided by 2, so you have to take care here. And you can also prove transcendence of a number like, say, if a is an integer, so say a is a positive integer, you can prove the transcendence of a continued fraction, a number defined by the following continued fraction, a plus 1 over a square plus 1 over a 4 plus 1 over a 2 to the n. So a number like this can be proved to be transcendental by this method. But now we have a major deficiency with Mahler's method. So, of course, there are many people who are working on such kind of examples and prove interesting result about transcendence and algebraic independence for this infinite product of continued fraction or series. But the major deficiency is the following one. So it is expected that no value at an algebraic point of a Mahler function is a classical transcendental number. So this informal statement just told you that we do not expect to prove the transcendence of pi or zeta values or other interesting number with Mahler's method. So if you want to prove, if you are interested in the transcendence of a single number with Mahler's method, it told you that you will have this kind of funny examples, but nothing related to classical arithmetic. Okay? But still, there is still a big interest in proving transcendence results for this kind of big system here. And in the 80s, van der Poorten wrote a paper in which he explained what, for him, was the main direction in Mahler's method, and especially the result he would like to prove, and he said he mostly proved, but unfortunately he never completely proved these results. So I'm going to explain these two main directions. So in transcendence, the main goal So for transcendence of matter functions, not for algebraic independence, only for transcendence, is the following. So imagine that f of z belong to L of z, where L is a number field. So if you want the field of rational number, and you assume that f of z is a Mahler function, so for some integer k, it satisfies an equation like the star equation on the left. So it is a Mahler function. So, and let alpha be an algebraic number, which we assume to be in the disk of convergence of f. Then what we expected is the following alternative. So, say either the value f of alpha belong to the field L, the number field L in which your coefficient belong, or f of alpha is transcendental. And it is known that you cannot expect something better than this. So there are Mahler functions which assume at some algebraic point values in the field of coefficient. So this is the best things you can hope. And it would have a nice consequence. So okay, I'm going to write this here. Okay, so imagine you are able to prove this. So what you will have is possibly the transcendence of many, say, uninteresting number for arithmetician. But the point is that if you have such a general result, you will have, it would have some good consequence for numbers that everybody like, which are algebraic number. So a corollary of that would be the following one. If you choose an integer, at least 2, b, then the base b expansion of an algebraic irrational number cannot be produced by a finite automaton. So now I'm going to explain a bit what does it mean. So we know that algebraic number, and in particular algebraic irrational number, are computable numbers, so which means that there exists a Turing machine that can produce the digits in any base, the digits of your number. But if you look at the decimal expansion of square root of 2, you will see that the digits looks more or less random, so there is some complexity behind. And people have tried to obtain formal result to explain this complexity. And one way is to look at the computational complexity. So here, basically, we replace a Turing machine by some very restricted class of Turing machines. So basically, a Turing machine with finite memory, which is a finite automaton. And then we say, OK, the digits of algebraic number they are too complex to be produced by such a simple way. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm going to give an example. And so why this is a corollary of that one is the fact that if AN is a sequence of digits produced by a finite automaton, if AN is produced by a finite, say, k automaton, So, which means, I'm going to give an example, but this means that there is a finite state machine that reads as input the base key expansion of n and produces as output an. So, you, as input, you give the base key expansion of n, the finite state machine will produce an. So, if this is the case, an is said to be k automatic. And if you look at the generating series, sum of an, zn, it will be called also a k-automatic series. And the point is that if you have a k-automatic series, it satisfies a K-Malloy equation. So now if you consider a sequence produced by a finite automaton, it is k-automatic. So the series is k-automatic, so it is a K-Malloy function. And if you look at the point 1 over b, so if you are interested in f of 1 over b, so 1 over b, of course, is an algebraic number. The coefficients are the digits, so they are integers. So you will get that either f of 1 over b is rational or is transcendental. So it cannot be algebraic irrational. So this shows you that this one implies this one, if you believe me when I say that a k-automatic function is k-Malloy. So an example is the following one. So example of a two-automatic sequence. Which is the one we always give in automata theory, it's a two-Morse sequence. An. So it is defined as an is equal by definition to the sum of the binary digit of n modulo 2. So the sequence assumes values that are either 0 or 1. So it's a binary sequence. And it is produced by the following automaton, which has two states, A and B. It can read the binary expansion of any numbers, like this. So when you read a zero, you remain in the same state. And when you read a one, you move to the other states. And the production sequence is given like this. If you read the binary expansion of n, and you end at the state A, you will produce a 0. And if you end at the state B, you will produce a 1. And the sequence you will get is exactly the sum of the binary digits of n mod 2. So this is why we say that an is 2 automatic, because it's produced by a finite automaton that reads as input the binary expansion of n. And if you choose this particular example, you will see that it satisfies the following equation. So if I call ft for two morse of z, the sum of an, zn, so which belong to z of z, so it satisfies the following equation, z over 1 minus z squared, minus f of z minus 1 plus z f of z squared is equal to 0. So it's written in an unhomogeneous way, but you can easily find a homogeneous equation of this type. So it's a two-Malloy function. And this is true in full generality. If you have a K-automatic series, it is K-Malloy. Okay, so yes, one important comment is that the main goal I erased is still an open question. So it's still not known whether Malloy function take values at algebraic point in the field of definition of coefficient or are transcendental. But the corollary here is something I proved some years ago in 2007 in joint work with Bugeaud. So it's joint work with Yann Bugeaud. And the way, story is amusing because the way we proved the corollary has nothing to do with Mahler's method. It used the so-called periodic version of the subspace theorem of Schmidt, so which is a big tool in Diophantine approximation. So now the corollary is available, but the first result is not. And because the method we use here does not really give algebraic independence result, it would be very interesting to make the Mahler's method work for this automatic case. And I'm currently working on that. So now I gave you the first main goal for transcendence, but in his paper, Van der Porten gave another goal, and the idea was, so this another main goal of Mahler's theory. The idea is whether we could say something about transcendence when working with two different transformations, say Z gives Z2 and Z gives Z3 jointly. So, for instance, if I consider the series, say F1 of Z is the sum of the Z to Z2 to Zn, is clearly a two Mahler function. Okay? And F2 of Z, which is defined as the sum of the Z to Z3 to Zn, is a three Mahler function. So this one is three Mahler, and this one is two Mahler. So this one has something to do with base 2, this one with base 3, and what you hope is that now if alpha is an algebraic number in the open unit disk, you hope that F1 of alpha and F2 of alpha are algebraically independent. There is no relation between these numbers. Or at least what you may hope is that F1 of Z and F2 of Z, so here this means over Q bar, are algebraically independent over the field of rational function, Q bar of Z. So of course, if you have the algebraic independence of the values, it implies the algebraic independence of the function, and the converse is not true. So this is typically what you would expect. And the very nice idea with Mahler's method is that what you would like to do is to use several variables, function with several variables to prove such kind of result. For instance, you put G1 of Z1, Z2 is F1 of Z1, and G2 of Z1, Z2 is F2 of Z2. So you both functions now have different variables. Okay? So, for instance, because F1 and F2 are easily shown to be transcendental functions, so they are algebraically independent. So now we have two algebraically independent functions, and we may hope to prove algebraic independence of the values. So the idea of Loxon and van der Porten was to look at transformation like T of Z1, Z2 give Z1 square, Z2 to Z3. And the idea was to prove algebraic independence of G1 of alpha alpha and G2 of alpha alpha for some algebraic number alpha. So roughly this is the idea. So because now we have two algebraically independent functions for trivial reason, just because they have different variables. So we go from transcendence to algebraic independence of function, and then we can hope to have the algebraic independence of values. But this one is just F1 of alpha And this one is just F2 of alpha. So this gives the algebraic independence of the values, and this implies the algebraic independence of the function. So you get the algebraic independence of the function in a very, very special way. So it's clearly unusual. But if the hope of van der Poorten would work, so he was hoping to prove a general result of this type, it would have the following consequence. And the following consequence would be a corollary of the main goal. And this is a theorem I prove with Bell, and I want to present today. So the theorem can be read like this. So let K be a field, and then a power series f of z in kz is both k-matter. Okay, I also fix k and l to multiplicatively independent natural number integers. So now, so for instance, 2 and 3, and we assume that our power series is both k-matter and l-matter. And the theorem told you that this is possible if and only if f of z is a rational function. So, so which means that what you expect is that if you have a k-matter function which is not rational and a l-matter function which is not rational, then both should be really different. Plainly, they should be algebraically independent functions. And so what we prove is that it's not possible that the same function is both k-matter and l-matter. Okay? So, van der Poorten would like to prove this corollary by using transcendence and algebraic independence machinery with Mallard's method. And again, we prove this result by a completely different method. Okay? Just one word about this corollary. So, one of the main motivations for that corollary is the following one. Is again something which has to do with automata theory. So this theorem is a generalization, a far-reaching generalization of a theorem due to Cobham which is a fundamental result of automata theory. So the result of Cobham is the following. So you consider a subset of the integers. Let S be a subset of integer. And you imagine that then, okay, if S is both recognizable by a K automaton, and the L automaton, then S is a finite union. S is a union of a finite set and finitely many arithmetic progression. So what is the meaning of this result? So you can use Turing machine or automata to recognize some set of integers. So if a set of integer is, say, computable, so recognizable by a Turing machine, this means that there is a Turing machine that take your integer and select them, and they select exactly the member of your set S, and to be recognizable by a Turing machine, of course, does not depend on the way the integers are written. If they are written in base 2 or in base 3, you don't care about this. But if you consider more restricted Turing machine, namely finite automaton, then the base in which you read the integer is very important. So if you, here, of course, we are in the same situation than here, so K and L are multiplicatively independent. So, which means that if there is a finite state machine that reads an integer in base 2 and select exactly the member of S, and if you now you write the integer in base 3 and the, another machine can select the same set of integers, then it's only a finite set and the union of finitely many arithmetic progression. So this is only possible for trivial set. Okay? So it's also tells you that base 2 and base 3 are really different. So the idea, the point with this theorem, so it's due by Cobham in 1969. And so Cobham proves, Cobham's proof is not really hard. So van der Potten said it's locally easy, but globally hard. So which means that it's not hard to follow step by step, but you don't really understand why it works. So it has been simplified, and there are several other proofs, but there is a search for a more conceptual proof of Cobham's theorem that will be will have more insight. And the idea of van der Potten was to use transcendence and algebraic independence machinery to derive these results and then to obtain this as a corollary. Okay, so this was the main aim of van der Potten. Because of course, here, if you have a set S, you can look at the generating series of the set. It will be both K automatic and L automatic, so it will be both K Mahler and L Mahler, so it will be a rational function with finitely many coefficients as values, so which means that the status sequence of coefficients is eventually periodic, which gives you the result. So this one implies that one. Okay, so unfortunately, the way we prove with Bell this corollary relies on Cobham's theorem. So we do not obtain an independent proof of Cobham's theorem and a new proof of Cobham's theorem, but instead we use Cobham's theorem. But the reduction is far from being trivial. Yeah?
Cobham's theorem, I remember there was a key result that for a long time did not have a completely satisfactory proof. Is that the one? Or
sorry?
Is the proof of Cobham's theorem now completely satisfactory? Is it a problem that it does not give a second derivative?
No, the proof is okay, but the point is that it's not really meaningful. So people would like to have a more conceptual proof. I mean, it's like a Zemeredi theorem and the proof by Fürstenberg. You know, it's something similar. So the proof is okay, but it's quite hard to understand. Sorry for this comment. So that's why it would be very interesting to prove the algebraic independent statement of van der Potten in order to reprove this one and then to get the corollary, the Cobham theorem as a corollary by another way. So I will try to explain. So the proof is quite long actually, and I plan to give the main ingredient of the proof, but probably I will not have time to do that. So Christian, you have. But I can just explain one very small part of the proof, which concerns reduction mod P. So, because with Mahler function, something very special happened, and it's not hard to see. So we have a sort of what I call a local global principle, which is very useful. I can just describe it briefly. So in order to simplify, so actually, even if a K-matter function has coefficient in a given field, actually the coefficient does not span all the fields, so they are restricted to a finitely generated Z-algebra of the field. So for instance, essentially, if you are in a number field, the coefficients are actually in a number ring, the principal localization of a number ring. So we may assume, for instance, that R is a number ring. So just what I want to say is that there are trivial tricks to reduce from, oh, let K be a field. Sorry, there is something wrong with my theorem of characteristic zero. This is not proof for field of characteristic P. So there are tricks to go from any field of characteristic zero to number field, which are sort of routine. So now if you have a number ring and F of Z is a K and L matter with coefficient in this number ring, imagine that there exist, so if there exist infinitely many prime ideals in R, say beta, in R, such that Fp of Z, so the reduction mod P of your function, so which means that you reduce mod P the coefficient. So now you get a series, sum of an mod p, zn, which is in a residue field r over p of z. So imagine that for infinitely many prime ideals, this reduced function is rational. Then F itself is rational. And it's not really not hard to prove this result. But what is surprising is that if you look at the same thing with, instead of K-matter function for J function, so at the beginning of my talk, I was speaking about J functions. The same thing is expected, at least if you prove it for almost every prime ideals. But it's still an open question. So it's usually difficult to go from rationality mod P to global rationality. But for Mahler function, it's possible. And it comes from the fact that if you start with an equation comes like this, and you reduce mod P, you will get a new equation of this form, the equation mod P. And the point is that if your solution mod P is rational, the degree of the numerator and denominator can be bounded only by the degree of the initial coefficient. So it does not depend on the ideal you fix to reduce. It's independent of the size of the ideal. And then linear algebra implies easily the result. Okay, so it really comes from this kind of equation. So now you see what could be the idea is that imagine you find infinitely many prime ideals for which your function, which is both K Mahler and L Mahler, so mod P, it becomes K automatic and L automatic. Then for all these ideals, Cobham's theorem will tell you that it's rational function. And because there is another version of Cobham's theorem like this. And then you will have rationality mod P for infinitely many ideals, and you will be done. So the difficulty is to prove that you can find infinitely many ideals such that the reduction mod P is both not K Mahler and L Mahler, but K automatic and L automatic. And for this, this is a long way to prove this, and there are several arguments. So there is an analytic part where we prove that something we have to care about are the root of P0 in our equation, so the singularities of the equation. And so we want to avoid, for instance, a root like this. So if there is a root of unity such that omega to the kj is equal to omega, and P0 of omega is equal to zero, we will be in a trouble for the proof. So we start with a function which is both k and L matter. So we have an equation like this for, with k and another one with L. And for the one with k, we want to prove that there is no such a root. In general, there may be such kind of root, but because the function is also L-Mahler, we can use analytic argument to prove that we can remove this kind of root. And this is an important part of the proof. So we have to consider analytic estimate around the unit circle to prove that we can remove this kind of root. And another thing we have to do that I'm not really the time to, unfortunately, to describe, is so we decompose our function f of z as a sort of product like this. We have f of z is a product of, say, n0 of z kg. So we do the same for L. The product of 1 over R1 of z kg and a new function g of z. So what's happened is that this product here, the both product, they come from P0. P0, we look on once, we split it in two parts. The part where all the roots are roots of unity of P0, and a part where no roots of P0 are roots of unity. So the unit part and the non-unit part. So here, this is the unit part, if I put just a z. And here, this is a non-unit part. So the unit part, because we can remove these singularities, so we have to work for that, then mod p, it is always p automatic. The function we have this, because of theory of k regular function, mod p, it's always p automatic. So, and we know also that the product of p automatic series is k automatic series is still k automatic. So we have two parts that now are under control. And for the last part, we need a trick where what we want is that for some n, say R1 of z to the kn, has no root mod p. So we want to find ideals such that this has no root mod p, while R1 of z split completely mod p. And this is for this this kind of statement are clearly designed to use a classical theorem from algebraic number theory, which is a Chebotarev theorem. So Chebotarev theorem will explain you things about the splitting mod p of polynomials if you have information on the Galois group of the splitting field. So we use Chebotarev theorem by constructing some particular element in the Galois group of the splitting field to prove that not now for every prime ideals, but only for infinitely many of them, actually a positive proportion of them, then this one also will be k automatic when reduced mod p. So at the end, we find infinitely many ideals so that every part mod p is k automatic, and at the same time, for the same ideals, it's also L automatic, and this allows to conclude the proof. Okay, so I think I'm almost done. I don't know, it's time to stop, more or less. Okay, if you have a question, I have a few comments I want. I can just add, okay, it's just, I may imagine that many of you are not necessarily familiar with the topic, and one motivation for me to prove this result comes from the fact that it reflects a nice principle, and there are many open questions of that type. Usually it's quite difficult to prove things like something happened with base 2 and with base 3 only in a trivial case. So I would like to give three open problems that relies on this principle and that are clearly clearly open. So just briefly, so the first one is due to Fürstenberg, so it has a dynamical flavor. And this is a times two, times three question. So I don't know if I have to recall this, but it is a fact that the question is it true that the only non-atomic probability measure, which is invariant by the action of times two on the circle and times three on the circle, is a Lebesgue measure? So if you have an invariant measure for times two and times three, it's only the trivial measure. So that is a Lebesgue measure if it's non-atomic. So this is the first. And it, there are some partial results, but as far as I know, it's still open. A second area where we find a problem like this is something which is usually attributed to Mahler. And so the problem is easy to explain. So you start with a sequence of a binary sequence, a sequence of 0 and 1s. And the question is it true that if the binary number sum of an 2 to the n and sum of an 3 to the n, so the same sequence of digits but view in base 3, if they are both algebraic, then this is possible if and only if both are rational number, which means that the sequence is actually eventually periodic. So again, if your number is algebraic in base 2 and in base 3, it can only happen in a trivial case where the sequence is periodic and both numbers are rational. So this one is also completely open, and it has something to do with the normality of algebraic numbers, so the expected normality of algebraic irrational numbers. And the last question, it arises in the work of Ramanujan. It's also completely open, so it's let T be a real number, and we assume that 2t is an integer. So it can happen when t is an integer, but it can also happen for other t, like some value of logarithm, like log 2. So we assume that 2 of t and 3 of t are integers. Then what is expected is that t is a natural number. So this is, of course, the trivial case. So if t is a natural number, then both are integers. So, but we expect that if 2 of t and 3 of t are both integers, this can only happen in this case. And this is a particular case of the well-known problem in transcendence theory, which is known as a four-exponential conjecture. If you had here 5t, then it is known, thanks to the six exponential theorem. But with 2 and 3, it's still open. And so all the three questions, they remain on this general principle. And as you see, it's easy to produce conjecture with the spirit, but it's usually hard to prove them. So it's nice to have one example, a non-trivial example, where we have a proof for this kind of result. So now I'm going to stop. I'll be